Good morning. Life is a symphony, and as you think about all the different parts that are played in life, this is one of the parts we have to go through, and it brings us together into this place today. But as I told the family just a moment ago, this service today reminds us of the life of Brother Owen Miller. We come together today not to mourn the dead, but to celebrate the living. Because Owen is very much alive today and in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. Most importantly, we come to honor and to celebrate the giver of that life, not just the physical life, but the spiritual life that was given to Brother Owen. We come to celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ. We celebrate Jesus and the gift of salvation that was purchased in His blood at Calvary and through the empty tomb. We celebrate the day that Owen trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior. We celebrate the promise of Scripture that says, absent from the body and in the presence of the Lord. We celebrate that Jesus had a place prepared in glory for Owen. And we celebrate that Owen is with Jesus, happy beyond comprehension, and the things that he has already experienced are just mind-boggling. So, yes, there's grief and sadness, but there's also much to rejoice in today. And so we want to try to turn our attention towards those things and give the Lord praise and honor and the glory. As we do that today, let's start with prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful for Jesus. And we are thankful, Lord, for all that you have made possible. For the gift of salvation, we thank you, Lord, that through the sacrifice of Jesus, that we can have our sins forgiven. Through His resurrection, we can have new life in Christ. And we thank you for that day that Brother Owen trusted you as his Savior. We thank you for receiving him home a week ago. And now today, as we go through these services that remembers and honors and recognizes his life, we pray that this family would receive your strength. Overshadow them today, Lord, with your grace and your mercy. And we'll be sure to thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. The passages of Scripture that I want to read are two passages that Owen said were his favorites. One is Psalm 103, and it's going to be just select verses out of this psalm. But the psalmist says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of His benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Like as a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him. For he knoweth our frame, he remembereth that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass, as flowers of the field, so he flourisheth. For the wind passeth over it, and it is gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him. Bless the Lord, bless ye the Lord, all ye his hosts, ye ministers of his that do his pleasure. Bless the Lord, all his works in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul." And then John's Gospel, chapter 3, and verse 16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." The family has requested that we would sing a song together, number 631 in your hymnal. So if you'd take a hymnal, and let's sing that together.
Here, beloved, I am longing for you.
On January the 14th, 1930, in Mount Hope, Holmes County, Ohio, the Amish home of the late Jonas and Elizabeth Swartzentruber Miller was blessed with the birth of a son, and they named him Owen. This wasn't just any Amish home. I was told that his mother's family was one of the largest sects of Amish in the world. Owen was farmed out as a 12-year-old to the A.D. Delagrange family, the founders of the Delagrange Builders, and became one of their family. Up until Owen was 16, his paycheck went back to support his family. When he became of age at 16, A.D. helped him emancipate, becoming his own man and independent. Owen now kept his own check and continued working for A.D. for a time. As Owen renounced the Amish ways and became an Englisher, this came at a great cost to him. He was shunned, he was excommunicated from his Amish family, and he was considered dead to them. Later in Owen's life, he received a letter from his mother that they had left the Amish community as well and had joined with the conservative Mennonites, and they wanted to rekindle the relationship with him, which they did. Owen was a carpenter working at Harlan Cabinets, Delagrange Builders, and Yoder Construction. He was a supervisor at Ellie Smith. He spent the last 15 years of his career as a supervisor at Bryan City Schools, where he was the boiler operator, retiring in 1996. Owen also started M W Countertops. Owen was a member of our church, and he had faithfully through the years served as both a deacon and a trustee. I've told many that I could take you through the church and show you all the different places where Owen's hands have touched. Owen loved to do woodworking. He built a rolltop desk for each of his boys and a beautiful hutch for Kathy. He also repaired clocks and chairs. As a young man, Owen met and fell in love with a young lady named Shirley Gump. On June the 18th, 1955, they made it official and became husband and wife. They enjoyed 51 years, 1 month, and 8 days together until Shirley went home to be with the Lord on July the 25th, 2006. Owen and Shirley's love produced a great family. Surviving are his three children, Keith and Christy Miller, Ken and Shelley Miller, and Kathy and Brian Davis, 6 grandchildren and 14 great-grandchildren. Owen is also survived by 2 sisters, Edna Wellert and Martha Dalpra, 1 brother, Monroe Miller, and he was preceded in death by his parents, wife, Shirley, 3 sisters, Ella Brown, Mary Keim, and Nettie Wingard, and 2 brothers, Jonas Miller, Jr., and Andrew Miller. On Thursday, January the 11th, a week ago, Owen went home to be with his Lord. And today we can rejoice with him and can only imagine the joys that he has experienced that far surpass the joys that he not only experienced, but the joys that he gave us this side of eternity. The personal memories coming from the family are these. First of all, from the George Rohrs family. It says, our family memories of Owen go back to the time when Owen and Shirley were dating. Our parents, George and Emma Rohrs, met them at the Hicksville Missionary Church. They recalled during an evangelistic service, Owen and Shirley going forward and giving their hearts to the Lord. Emma recalls times when Owen would stand to share a prayer request or testimony while still holding Shirley's hand. They were a very affectionate couple. Emma was Shirley's matron of honor at their wedding. There were many times that they would take turns going to one another's homes after church on Sunday night. We recall going to Owen and Shirley's home and smelling delicious coffee brewing and overhearing Owen and Dad talking about the Lord, the day's events, or politics. For years, our family would go to Owen and Shirley's for Thanksgiving dinner. They would always put on a fantastic spread. Owen would usually show us one of his latest woodworking projects. He even made us an aggravation game board, which we used many times. There were many times when we would go to visit family in Michigan that Owen would ask if there was anything that he could do for us while we were gone. He would always feed the dog and the livestock. Shirley even surprised our mom and scrubbed the kitchen floor. They went over and above all the time. We have great memories of going to the Bible and Missionary Conference at Beulah Beach in Ohio with the Miller family. The Bible says that a friend sticks closer than a brother. Owen was that type of friend. He was a faithful, loyal, and trustworthy friend. We were blessed that God put Owen in our lives, and we will miss him and his sweet smile. But we rejoice knowing that we will see him again very soon, until we meet again the George Rohrs family. Kaylee writes, my grandpa got on his knees to pray at the seat of his recliner right next to grandma. My grandpa worked with his hands, sawdust and saws, a few less fingers now. He created beautiful things. My grandpa loved to mow, to be outside, to feed the squirrels and the birds, to eat tomatoes right from the garden. My grandpa loved his grandchildren. He sat and he watched and he tried to understand. He gave rides on his walker. My grandpa was hard, complicated, and calloused, as some old men are, but his heart was soft. My grandpa is with my grandma now, both finally free from the pains of this place, walking with God, playing cards with friends. From Andy Miller, as I've reflected on the life of my grandpa, Owen Miller, there is one thing that keeps coming to mind, and that is his great faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. I once asked him what his favorite Bible verses were, and he told me John 3:16 and Psalm 103. My first reaction was, really? A verse that is so overquoted in our world and overused by so many people. But as I continued to reflect, I realized that it's a simple verse, but has such deep meaning and significance. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. It is a truly foundational verse for our faith in Christ, and it now brings a smile to my face because I know of Grandpa's faith in Christ, and I know that he is enjoying that eternal life right now. And then Ashley wrote this, my grandpa didn't hold any prestigious positions. He wasn't a prominent member of society, but when I would tell people who my grandpa was, they knew Owen Miller. They knew the man who was gentle and soft-spoken. They knew the man who was a skilled carpenter. They knew the man who loved his family. They knew the man who loved and lived for Jesus Christ. Every day, rain or shine, no matter what the day held, he started it at the kitchen table reading and studying God's Word. Every evening, he ended his day on his hands and knees, praying for our world, the church, those who were sick and hurting, and each and every one of his children, his grandchildren, and his great-grandchildren. He lived a wonderful life and left an amazing legacy. Grandpa, I am forever grateful for your love, guidance, wisdom, and support. Your presence in my life has made a profound impact on who I am today. I love you. At this time, Brother John Drennan comes to sing a song.
children, precious children, I know you're shaken. A loved one taken. Oh, but hear me. Come, draw near me. Their pain is past now. They rest at last now. Safely home. They are strong and free. They are merely shadow. Today there's sorrow, but joy tomorrow. Safely they are strong and free. They are safe with me. One day join them all together. This time forever. Safely home. Safely home.
For those who really knew Owen, you know that he probably would have been very uncomfortable with all the attention that we've given him. He was a quiet, bashful kind of a guy, reserved. He was a man of few words. He wasn't a talker. And many times when you'd have a conversation with Owen, he would jump into the middle of a conversation because he'd already had the front half of the conversation in his own mind with himself. And so he would jump into the middle of it, and you're just like, wait a minute, we need to back up, I'm missing something. And then he'd go ahead and have it with you. When he was first out at the assisted living apartments and more communicative, we would usually talk about prophecy. And it was his topic. He would bring it up. And he tied in the world events. He was watching the news. He was reading the books and things like that. And, of course, reading his Bible and putting it all together. And that was where his heart was at. His heart was in the Word of God. His Bible was not a book that sat on a table, but it was a book that was used, and it was worn, and it was marked up because he had been so faithful in it through the years. So the passage that I've chosen for the message is certainly fitting for Owen, and it focuses on what would have been the most important things in his life that he would have wanted shared. In Matthew chapter 7, the Scripture says, "Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And every one that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man, which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it." Let's talk first of all about salvation. As we've stated, Owen had been a builder. Owen knew what it meant to have the foundation correct. You had to have the foundation right before you build a house. You had to have the frame of the cabinet right. It had to be square before you built the rest of the cabinet. You had to have the right material for the countertop before you could lay the laminate down or whatever the countertop was going to be. Jesus is talking about something far greater than houses and cabinets and countertops. He is talking about building a life upon the foundation of the Lord Jesus Christ. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11, the Bible says, "For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ." The world will tell us that there are many ways that we can get to heaven, that, you know, you can try this and you can try that and you can do your best over here and over there. But the Bible tells us that there is only one way to God. There is only one way into the kingdom of heaven, and you must be born again. John chapter 14 and verse 6, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me." When Owen and Shirley both, when they heard that gospel message at that evangelistic meeting, they knew that, and here's a man that had learned carpentry and everything else, he knew that his foundation wasn't right, and he had to get it right. And the only way to get it right was through Jesus Christ. Everyone sitting here this morning, as well as everybody in this entire world, is in one of two categories. You're either saved or you're lost. You're wise or you're foolish. Your house is built upon a rock or your house is built upon the sand. The house that will stand the test of time and eternity is the house that's been built upon Jesus Christ. The house that will crumble and fall and will spend an eternity in hell is that which has been built on the sandy shores of good works and religion and church attendance and prideful endeavors or whatever it might be. There's just not an in-between category. Psalm chapter 18 and verse 2, the Bible says, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my buckler, and the horn of my salvation and my high tower." Can you say that that is true of your life this morning? Can you say that your life is built on the right foundation, the only foundation that you can build your life on, that it is built on the Lord Jesus Christ? Owen's was and had been for nearly 70 years, and yours can be today. You say, "Well, how do I do that? How do I know how to build a house? I know how to build a cabinet. I know how to do a countertop. How do you get your life built on the Lord Jesus Christ?" The Bible tells us that if we will confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our hearts that God has raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. In Acts chapter 16, the Philippian jailer said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they gave a very simple answer: "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." I wasn't there when Owen and Shirley walked that aisle at that evangelistic meeting. I don't know what took place. I don't know who was preaching, but I can tell you exactly what Owen and Shirley did. They called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved, and they were saved. It's that simple. And you say, "Well, I've done that, and." There is no "and." If you put an "and," then it's no longer the gospel message. You say, "I've done that, period. I have accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. I have called upon the name of the Lord and believed that He died for my sins and that He was buried in the tomb and that He arose again from the grave. I have called on that Jesus to save my soul." Have you done that? Can you point to the time in your life where you've done that? You say, well, I've always believed. Not unto salvation you haven't. Not unto salvation. Oh, and being brought up in an Amish community as a religious community, right? I mean, there's nobody would deny that the Amish are very religious. When he went to live with A.D., I was told that A.D. would have been influential in having him in church and bringing him out of the Amish. I don't know where A.D. went to church at, but I know that he did. Okay, that's great. And Owen had religion long before he had relationship. Religion don't get you into heaven. Religion takes a person to eternity and hell. It is relationship. It is the person, Jesus Christ, that takes you to heaven someday. And though Owen had had religion for 20 plus years of his life, he didn't have relationship until the day he called on the name of Jesus to be saved. And I know that Owen would have desired that for every one of your lives, is that you would know Christ personally as your Savior, and that you would be able to say, this is when I gave my life to Christ. Once we give our life to Christ, and what we saw in Owen's life is surrender. Salvation comes first. You cannot surrender until there's been salvation. Once there's been salvation, you surrender. There's an invitation song called I Surrender All. Let me read to you some of the lyrics. All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. All to Jesus I surrender. Humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. All to Jesus I surrender, make me Savior, wholly thine. Let me feel thy Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. All to Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. Owen was a man that not only had trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior, he had known salvation, but he lived a life of surrendering to the Lord. In Philippians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul says, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. You watched Owen through the years, and especially for the family that saw him all the years of their lives. And as you saw the life of Owen, you saw a guy, he was straight as an arrow. I mean, this was just a guy that, you talk about somebody that knew how to fly right. He knew how to fly right. And he would let you know if you weren't, or if something wasn't flying right in the world, he would tell you about it. And he knew exactly what the Scripture has to say. He was surrendered to the Lord. He wanted to make the Lord the master, the ruler of his life. He wanted the Lord to make him the man of God that he ought to be. And you watch that develop. Now, here's a neat illustration that hit me with this. Many of you possess the beautiful pieces that Owen made for you. How many of you have one of his pieces? Just put your hand up. Oh, look at that. We've got a coat rack that he made for us. I think one Christmas he got into the coat rack making thing, and went over to his garage and into his shop, and coat racks, coat racks, coat racks, coat racks. They're all over the place. Somebody's got a lot of coats, Owen, and he's just making them for gifts and giving these away. When you look at the beautiful pieces that he made, whether it was the rolltop desk, whether it was the hutch, whether it was a cabinet or anything else, you saw the completed project. What you didn't see was how it all started. It started as a tree in somebody's woods that got cut down. And then it was taken to a mill and it was ripped into planks. And then those planks were either kiln dried or more than likely they were air dried over time. It takes a lot of years for those things to air dry. Once the board was purchased, it probably still had the bark on it. And I'm sure that Owen had several boards through the years that had just come right out of the kiln or they had done their time air drying and they were ready to be used. They still had the bark on them. So now they have to be planed. They have to be run through the joiner and the bark comes off and things like that. But still, it's an unsightly, unshapely board. And now it's cut into pieces. And those pieces are formed and shaped to become that hutch, that cabinet, that roll-top desk, all those many, many, many coat racks. But it's still not done. Now it's going to get sanded. And it's going to get sanded some more. And it's going to get sanded some more. And then it's going to get stained. And then it's going to get lacquered. And then it shows up at your house and is usable. But think of this whole process that took place. It took a master carpenter to get it from that tree that was once standing in the woods to that beautiful piece of furniture that is now sitting in your home. And you have that wonderful memory of the work that Owen did. But it took a master carpenter to get it there. Do you realize that that is exactly what the Lord Jesus Christ wants to do to every one of our lives? Once we have accepted Christ as Savior, the tree came down in the woods. And it was pulled out of the devil's forest and brought into the Lord's workshop. And the master carpenter begins to work on us. And it takes years. And he does a lot of cutting and fitting and sanding and staining, and sometimes we're going to redo that piece, and we're going to fix this, and we're going to fix that, before it can ever become what it was intended to be. It takes the master carpenter to do that in our lives. Owen gave us the illustration of that. He showed us what a master carpenter could accomplish, and he did beautiful work. Let me tell you something. Owen didn't do beautiful work compared to the work that the Lord Jesus Christ wants to do in your life. Now that's a masterpiece, because we were far worse than an old tree standing out there in the woods, weren't we? But we've got to be surrendered to that. We've got to allow the Lord to do that kind of work in our life. Let me ask you this. Suppose up here on the platform, you could have brought in some of the pieces that Owen made. So we set those pieces up here. But in the midst of those pieces, and we don't tell anybody else, we put some solder pieces up here. And we'll put some IKEA pieces up here. Could you spot the difference? Absolutely. You could spot it very easily, very quickly. You see, who in the world would want to settle for solders and IKEA when you could have an original Owen masterpiece? When the master carpenter is wanting to work on our life, Christians, we are too settled to be an IKEA or a solder piece rather than being the piece that the master carpenter wants to make of our life. Functional? Sure. Look okay? Yeah. But it's still not what a master carpenter can do. Why settle? Why settle? If Owen had said, "I will make every piece of furniture, every cabinet, everything in your house," you'd have been a fool to say, "Oh no, I don't want that. I'd rather go to IKEA. I want to build with thousands and thousands of parts and have lots left over." You'd be a fool if he was going to outfit your house. How many Christians are fools that won't surrender their life to Christ and let him make a beautiful piece out of your life? Wow. Salvation, that's where it starts. Then surrender. But as we surrender to the Lord, we got to follow that up with service. We're called to service. 1 Corinthians 3 again says, "For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry, ye are God's building, according to the grace of God which is given unto me. As a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, another buildeth thereon, but let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon." Serving the Lord. I don't remember there ever being a time where I asked Owen if he would do something, and he said no. Owen was always willing to serve. He was always to do whatever he could do. When he and Shirley first started coming to the church, we used to tease them about the mission trips they took. You say, why would you tease somebody about going on a mission trip? They went to Hawaii. It's like, oh, mission trip, you know, wink, wink, right, mission trip. you and Miss Shirley were out there in your flowered shirts and khaki pants and sipping on a little thing out of a coconut shell, you know, walking a beach. Sure, mission trip. And then he'd kind of chuckle, you know, how he'd chuckle. No, he says, we built churches and we built homes and we've done this and that and all that kind of stuff. And I says, so you really actually did work when you was in Hawaii, right? Yeah. He always looked forward to anything he could do to serve the Lord. That service to the Lord is something that all of us are supposed to do. Why? Well, number one, think about who saved us and who is shaping us. Why wouldn't we want to serve that Lord? But if we want to just be truly self-centered and selfish about it, think of it this way. Great is our reward. Because there are rewards laid up for us in heaven. And as we give our life and service to the Lord and we let the Lord take us and use us, great is the reward. Can you imagine Brother Owen being welcomed home? And maybe the Lord saying to him, enter into your rest. Great is your reward. It makes serving the Lord and surrendering to the Lord fully worth it, doesn't it? You see, death took absolutely nothing from Owen. Took nothing from him. He doesn't have a body that is broken any longer, that is hurting, that is struggling to breathe. Nobody in heaven is having to yell at him so he can hear him. His hearing's perfect. He wore glasses. You don't need them anymore. Those fingers that were lost in a saw or a planer or something, they're back. Death took nothing from him. Death gave him everything. When the Lord called him home and out of this world, death opened up the blessings and the glories of heaven. And never once will he ever have to come back and face any of the things here. Isn't that wonderful for him? You say, yeah, but what about us? We're the ones hurting today. Yeah, I understand that. But that hurt is temporary. And that hurt is going to get better and better and better every day. Because God is going to do a work in your hearts, reminding you, giving you the peace to accept the glories of where Owen is at today. And it's not because Owen was this great guy and a great carpenter and all this kind of stuff. It is because Jesus saved him. And that is going to provide you comfort. And I know it's difficult today. And it will be. But there will be the joy that is going to emerge through it all. But maybe you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. You don't need to be worried about surrender and service because you're not saved. You say, oh, I go to church all the time. Big deal. Oh, I'm involved in my church. I work in my church. So what? That don't get you to heaven. Owen was not asked, how much did you do for me? He was not asked, how many churches did you belong to? He was not asked, how much money did you give? Only one thing was necessary, and that was to be covered in the blood of the Lamb. You must be born again. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed. I don't know who knows Christ as their Savior and who doesn't. There's no way I could. But you know, and God knows. So let's do business with God right now. If you're here without Jesus Christ as your Savior and you say, I want that life. I want that born-again life. A life that can surrender and serve the Lord, but I need salvation first. I need my sins forgiven. And would you pray something like this? And it's got to be your heart, your words, but this is just to help you. Pray something like this. Lord, I'm a sinner, and I know it. I don't deserve your grace. I don't deserve your mercy. I don't deserve your love, your forgiveness. But that's the definition of grace and mercy. Getting what I don't deserve and being rescued from that which I do deserve. And today, Lord, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I believe Jesus died for those sins. And he shed his blood and it paid the price in full. There's nothing else that can be done. But I also believe he is risen. Our Lord and Savior is alive. And I believe that. And I call upon him right now to save my soul. I ask Jesus to come into my heart and save me. Nobody looking around, but this morning I wonder, did you pray something like that? And you say, I meant it. If you did, would you just slip your hand up? Nobody looking around. Just slip your hand up if you did. Then our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for Jesus. We thank you for the joys that we had of knowing Owen and the continuing joys we have of reminiscing about just the good times, the funny times, the special times. We thank you, Lord, for the legacy that he left behind. And now, Lord, it's up to a family to carry that legacy on. And I pray for the kids, for the grandkids, that they would see the difference that Jesus made. And they would say, I want to carry on where Dad and Grandpa left off. Give them, Lord, the courage and the strength to do that. We thank you, Lord, for the peace and the grace that you give in the times like this. And we give it all to you in the name of Jesus. Amen.